So abdominal this is our topic on abdominal tuberculosis. According to the WHO global report in 2017, extrapulmonary tuberculosis accounts for 15-20% of all cases of tuberculosis. And the involvement of the abdomen is the third most common site after lymph node and pleura. There's a high index of suspicion is essential to reach a correct diagnosis. Early diagnosis remains difficult due to the non-specific clinical presentations. Mode of spread is already discussed, and reactivation of dominant primary GI focus, hematogenous route, and ingested mycobacteria from the sputum inactive lung lesions, direct or contiguous spread from adjacent organs and through the lymphatics of infected lymph nodes. Peritoneal involvement is the most common form of abdominal tuberculosis in 58% of cases, and intestinal involvement is seen in 40% of cases. Classification based on a pattern of infection. Abdominal tuberculosis can be luminal or intestinal, peritoneal involvement, visceral involving solid organs or lymph nodes. Intestinal TB is grossly classified based upon pathology. It's ulcerative lesions in 60% of cases, hypertrophic in 10% of cases, and ulcero-hypertrophic in 30% of cases, then fibrotic. And ileocecal region is the most common site involved in 44-93% of cases. It's because of relatively narrow lumen in this area and the slowing of intestinal transit and abundant lymphatics in this area. Peritoneal involvement, the clinical presentation, mainly three forms are described: wet ascitic type, dry adhesive type, and fibrotic fixed type. A rare presentation is an abdominal cocoon. Is an overlap of these three forms with the encapsulation of the bowel and the loculated ascites, usually presenting with the abdominal features of intestinal obstruction. And the classic Navi feel to abdomen is associated with a fibroadhesive form and is seen in less than 13% of cases. So the risk factors for abdominal tuberculosis are diabetes mellitus, HIV infection, cirrhosis, immunosuppression, and underlying malignancy. Clinical presentation depending upon the site and type of involvement. In small intestine, the predominant ulcerative lesions usually presenting with a chronic diarrhea and features of malabsorption. And if the lesion is a stricturous lesion, usually presenting with the features of intestinal obstruction. In large intestine, the ulcerative lesion usually presenting with a rectal bleeding. Sometimes massive bleeding can occur. And the hypertrophic lesion usually presenting with the abdominal mass or features of intestinal obstruction. Peritoneal involvement, the usual presentation is ascites with abdominal distension and vague abdominal pain. The adhesive form is usually presenting with obstruction because of the fibrotic bands and the obstruction of the pressure effect on the intestinal loop. Lymph node enlargement usually presenting with abdominal lump or obstruction. Another entity is hepatobiliary TB. It's a rare presentation. It refers to either localized isolated hepatic involvement or isolated biliary involvement or hepatobiliary involvement. The presentation, it's either as a local with a focal involvement of liver tuberculosis, primary complex with acquisition of associated lymph nodes, miliary tuberculosis, that is the commonest form of hepatic TB. Generalized disease results in an attack on the liver by clustered miliary tuberculosis. Then tuberculosis or granulomatous hepatitis. The clinical features usually asymptomatic or presenting with the right upper quadrant non-specific abdominal pain. And jaundice is uncommon. If it is present, it usually indicates the involvement of the biliary tract. Diagnosis, it's difficult to diagnose the abdominal tuberculosis because of its low positivity of microbial test. And there's a Postian's criteria suggests that the diagnosis be established if any one of the following four criteria are observed. The histology showing tuberculosis with accumulating necrosis, suggestive operative findings and consistent histology from mesenteric lymph nodes, animal inoculation and a culture showing growth of mycobacterium tuberculosis, or histology showing acid fast bacilli in the lesion. But again, with this criteria, it's very difficult to diagnose. So there is a Logan's modification that included a response to ATT therapy. Investigations in all patients with a suspected abdominal tuberculosis X-ray chest should be done to detect active or past evidence of pulmonary tuberculosis. May be detectable in 25% of cases. That Mantoux test, it is compromised by false positive and false negative results. False positive result can occur in BCG vaccination, cross reaction with other mycobacteria, and false negative results can occur in immunosuppressed patients, disseminated tuberculosis, recent infection, and the extremes of age. These two tests are considered as ancillary tests and cannot be used as standalone tests. Interferon gamma release assay is a slightly superior to Mantoux test because there's no cross reactivity with the BCG or other bacteria, and positivity is consistent with the mycobacterium tuberculosis infection but cannot be used to diagnose active disease. So HIV testing should be performed in all patients suspected to have abdominal tuberculosis because the sero prevalence was 16.6% compared with those with the pulmonary tuberculosis. Radiological findings, CT has replaced the use of barium studies. It provides ability to detect intraluminal and extraluminal abnormalities. So findings supportive of a diagnosis in CT scan, the presence of ascites, peritoneal thickening and enhancements, omental nodularity and thickening of the bowel wall, intestinal strictures, TB strictures, tuberculosis strictures are usually short, smooth and concentric. Its immediate differential diagnosis is Crohn's disease. In Crohn's disease, the strictures are usually elongated, serpiginous, and eccentric, then with the cobblestoning after ulcerations. So, presence of pulmonary lesion, hypodense center in an enlarged lymph node, suggestive of necrosis and ascites. These three features are highly suggestive of tuberculosis. CT endography, MR endography are used for delineation of structures in patients with intestinal stricture. Ascitic fluid study, peritoneal tuberculosis, the ascitic fluid is usually straw color, lymphocyte predominant, high protein, and low sac ascites. ADA value is a more than 39 unit per liter is indicative of peritoneal tuberculosis. The sensitivity is almost 100% and the specificity is 95% in diagnosing abdominal tuberculosis. The high false negative rate in presence of chronic liver disease. So in chronic liver disease, it is elevated but not up to the point in other conditions. So the cutoff value is more than 27 is in presence of chronic liver disease is considered as positive for tuberculosis. Ascitic cytology, three samples should be done to rule out peritoneal carcinomatosis, which is the immediate differential diagnosis of peritoneal tuberculosis. So in all patients, this cytology should be done to rule out peritoneal carcinomatosis. And peritoneal biopsy, laparoscopic peritoneal biopsy may be needed in some patients. If it is available, the yield is good because the abnormalities, presence of tubercles, enlarged lymph nodes, thickened peritoneum, and adhesions. So laparoscopy guided biopsy, the yield is more than 95%. So colonoscopy, it is the most important tool for the evaluation of intestinal tuberculosis. So adhesions include intestinal adhesions, including cancers, pseudopolyps, IC valve. Mucosal valve is commonly involved in tuberculosis and valve are involved in tuberculosis. Tuberculosis Crohn's. Diagnosis is based on fine needle aspiration. Either radiation or endoscopy guided from the involved segments. And the demonstration of acid fast bacillus. But presence of granulomas is not linked to tuberculosis. It can occur in so many other conditions. And the presence of kidney necrosis provides some degree of specificity to the outcomes. In the absence of demonstration of UFP and associated with necrosis. It is published in Journal of Gastroenterology, right? These are granulomas. In tuberculosis, the granulomas are multiple, large, confluent. Essence of granulomas are lining cancer. Submucous of granulomas, it is supposed to be mucous of granulomas. The absence of other signs, which is eating necrosis and in the minor because tuberculosis for the granulomas are made in the submucous gland. For more than 6 months, smear and culture for AFB are likely to be more than 50% of the cases. And PCR, this recent multiplex PCR using multiple probe provided a different results, but validation is required at present. It is available. And the extra pulmonary condition, it is of benefit of diagnosis. Therapeutic trial of ATT can also be used with the diagnosis assessment. It's an evaluation of abdominal tuberculosis. There's a suspicion of abdominal tuberculosis on the basis of symptoms and radiological findings. Requires detailed evaluation with the radiology, endoscopy, microbiology, and the histology. And confirmed tuberculosis means microbiological positivity and a specific gene probe positivity, expert MTB. So confirmed tuberculosis, you can straight away go for a four-drug regimen. And then follow-up, this is a monthly clinical assessment, and this follow-up should include objective and a subjective assessment. So monthly clinical assessment and objective assessment at 2 to 3 months. Endoscopy in patients with the intestinal tuberculosis or ultrasonography in patients with the abdominal ascites. And the improvement, the resolution of mucosal healing and resolution of ascites, continue follow-up until completion of ATT. With probable tuberculosis, there is a presence of granulomas, elevated ED in peritoneal tuberculosis, and exclusion of other diagnosis. Then again, initiate four-drug regimen. And if it is no improvement, then exclude resistant tuberculosis and alternate diagnosis. So abdominal tuberculosis treatment, the challenges include determining the appropriate duration of treatment, appropriate response to treatment, determining the endpoints of treatment, and recognition and treatment of sequelae of ATT. These are the challenges during treatment of abdominal tuberculosis. And several studies, including 3 RCTs and a cochrane meta-analysis, suggest that 6 months of treatment with the INS rifampicin tyrosinamide and ethambutol for 2 months and the INS rifampicin for 4 months is adequate for uncomplicated abdominal tuberculosis. These trials did not include prior ATT therapy, presence of HIV, comorbidities, and other forms of abdominal TB like hepatic tuberculosis. So in that case, modification is required. There's a proposed treatment according to stage of liver disease by S.K. Sarin et al., published in World Journal of Gastroenterology 2014. So depending upon the child status of the patient, liver cirrhosis and child status A, this is a compensated cirrhosis without complications. In that case, you can give 2 hepatotoxic drugs, namely INH and rifampicin, with or without pyrazinamide, this low dose, duration 6 to 9 months. But there's a controversial opinion. Some group advised to avoid pyrazinamide in all patients with the chronic liver disease. And the CTP-B, cirrhosis with some compensation, you can give 1 hepatotoxic drug in combination with other drugs. Pyrazinamide is generally avoided. And the duration generally 9 to 12 months. Then CTP-C means advanced liver disease, decompensated liver disease, no hepatotoxic drugs to be used. And all hepatotoxic drugs are contraindicated. So you can use second line drugs like streptomycin, ethambutol, fluoroquinolone, amikacin, kanamycin. And the duration is extended 12 months to 24 months. So follow-up of patients include both objective and subjective parameters for the assessment of response. In in intestinal tuberculosis, the immediate differential diagnosis is Crohn's disease, and both conditions may respond to EDT therapy, and global symptoms improvement occurs in both conditions. So mucosa demonstration of mucosal healing is essential by endoscopy, and at the end of therapy, complete healing occurs in tuberculosis, whereas only 5% of patients with the Crohn's disease show mucosal healing. Peritoneal tuberculosis, the subjective assessment by doing ultrasound to look for the resolution of ascites, it is an appropriate strategy. So persistence of symptoms, after treatment persistence of symptoms, you have to consider the conditions like secular disease, like stricture adhesion. So otherwise, patient may, it may result in unwarranted prolongation of treatment. So other other possibilities are, one is the development of drug resistance, or if no evidence of drug resistance and there is no sequelae of strictures, then consider alternate diagnosis. So surgical treatment is reserved for complications, especially acute presentation in the form of perforation, unremitting or recurrent intestinal obstruction, the stricture not amenable for endoscopic dilatation. Because in intestinal tuberculosis, the strictures are usually short, smooth, and concentric. So usually it will respond to endoscopic dilatation. If recurrent stricture not amenable for endoscopic dilatation, then only surgery is indicated. So in conclusion, abdominal tuberculosis remains an important concern in developing countries. The differentiation of intestinal tuberculosis from Crohn's disease is challenging and often necessitating a trial of ADT therapy. ADT therapy for 6 months is usually adequate for mucosal healing and the resolution of ascites. The sequelae of TB may result in persistence of symptoms needing endoscopic or surgical therapy.